Right, good evening, everyone. If you're from America and listening in, it's now good morning. If you're from England, it's good afternoon. And I presume everyone else is local, but welcome and thank you for joining this 2020 AGM. I've got a backdrop here, especially for anyone who might come from northern climes. If you are supporting the Lions, well, I just thought I'd put in a little reminder as a backdrop, just to entertain you during the afternoon's discussions. But you're all welcome. Thank you for giving up your time. As I say, this is a 2020 AGM, but we will take questions at the end and we'll ask you to put your questions in the chat group. And then we'll take them if you wish to ask on any other aspects of Masicorp either last year or this year. As far as apologies go, some have let us know that they can't be here and they're members of the board or their trustees. Andrew Smith, I'm not sure if he's sulking about Saturday's results, but he sent in an apology. Elise Taylor, Sandra Dodson, and Michael Charlie can't make it today. There have been other apologies, but they haven't been board members. Right, the first item on the agenda is the approval of the last year's minutes, the 2019 AGM held on the 8th of September. We had it late in the year, if you recollect, and had to have it virtually. It was the early days of Zoom, but we're now all very accomplished in it, and it holds no terrors whatsoever. So the approval of the minutes. Millie, how do people express that they're happy with it or second it?
We can vote on it. It was made available to everybody.
And how do we vote? I've just said now that we're all accomplished with Zoom, but I haven't a clue how you vote on it.
I'll approve the first and someone can second them.
So Megan, it might have to be you because everyone else's cameras are off.
I'm happy to second the minutes.
Thank you, Alistair.
Right, and then if anyone has an objection, come in on the chat group. Right, the third item on the agenda is the introduction of the Masicorp board. You do have here it comes up. The one change from this time last year from the AGM is that Doug Wallace has resigned and handed the ball on to me. So he's a new name. And then the other two, which will come in officially into next year's report, but I would like to mention them now because I don't want to wait a whole year before they're thanked. But that is Carol and John Thompson, who are singularly important to this whole Masicorp project that we're running. They founded it. They were the initiative. They had the vision to drive it. And ever since I've been involved, when people mention their names, they sort of mention in hushed whispers. So I would like officially now just to thank them for they are retiring from the main board, but they will still be supporting and helping the USA board. But for what they've done in the past, for the vision that they've shown, for the drive and the energy and the passion and everything else they've brought into, it's just a pity we couldn't have a round of applause for what they've done. And I think their legacy would be rather like Christopher Wren's with St. Paul's Cathedral. You know, just look around and you'll see their legacy. And that is certainly the case with Masicorp. Just look around and you see their legacy. And when you read all the projects that are happening and are running in Masicorp and you see what it has become over the 20 odd years, then you realize the massive amount of energy which they've poured into, which is now developed into this. So thank you, Carol and John. I don't know if you're listening, but everyone else will, I'm sure, join me in thanking you for what you've done. Right, so there'll be no other resignations. Various other people this year have offers have come to an end, but they've all been, they've all indicated they'd like to stand again. So there are no new members on the board at all. In fact, I'm the only new position. Right, the chairman's report. If we get on to the next slide, Terry. In the last year's meeting, Doug made this chairman's report stage made reference to COVID and what effect it was happening. I think we had probably little idea, and we certainly didn't dream in August last year that we would still be suffering with COVID. And we actually don't know what's going to happen. There's just so much uncertainty. And then this time last year, a couple of months after this, we had our fire in Masicorp, another catastrophe. And certainly the last 12 months, last 18 months have been one of just coping with crises and trying to keep going with our offering, our education offering that we do in so many areas. Now, Confucius said that they lived then, and that was thousands of years ago, in interesting times. I think Confucius would have something to say about the world in 2020 and 21. We're certainly in interesting times, and we're certainly in very, very challenging times. But with challenges, you bring out the best in people, and it is quite astounding to see how people have reacted to the challenges. I was in the Karoo when the fire happened, and I could only follow it on WhatsApp and what was happening. And, you know, just to see the goodwill of people all around the world and how they have supported Masicorp in its times of need has been very gratifying. So the fact that we are able to give a report of this nature, and I'd like to commend everyone on the management board who helped towards that magnificent brochure that's gone out. It is a very professional publication. It has a huge amount of detail in it, and it certainly promotes the name of Masicorp. So, Millie, to you and all your management team, that's a magnificent document. And that document really does show that the ship has been sailing. And for that, we have to commend the people who have been driving it. Firstly, the management board, the management team, the board themselves. You know, I think the management team has been the glue that has held everything together. The board have been great support in making sure that that ship stays on its course. And all the volunteers and everyone else around the world, yeah, it's the people that make Masicorp. And I salute you and I commend you for all you've done in this time of trouble that we've been going through recently. So I hope that when you sit wherever you are now and you listen to the watch the slideshow and you listen to what is happening, I think just be aware that behind it all, there've been a lot of people who put in a heck of a lot of effort, and I commend them all. And I'm sure if the Thompsons are watching, they're going to be proud of what they've seen. But thank you to everyone for being here and being part of it, and for your contributions that you've made during the year. Right, we're now going to move on to the next part, and that's a financial statement, and Alistair will talk us through that.
Thank you, Keith, for that introduction. And it's really a pleasure for me to be able to present these results, particularly under the circumstances that you described, the difficult times of the COVID and with the fire. So maybe you can go to the next slide. So, this is the financial position of Masicorp Malele Corporation SA. As Keith mentioned, it's the period from January 2020 to December 2020 that we're referring to here. So as you can see, the balance sheet is a very healthy position with just over 13 million of cash and cash equivalents, which is represented by 6 million of restricted donations, and a further 3.6 million of funding that has been received for future periods. Predominantly, that's the project we call the Vision 2020 project. And we're really seeing the fruits of that development and that investment to upscale and to develop the skill base within the organization to take us to the next level. So I think that's, the balance sheet is looking in a very healthy situation. And if you go to the next slide, this is the summary of the income and the movement in reserves. Again, this is the period from January to December 2020. And, despite the challenges that we received, it's fantastic that we, with the support of our donors and with the support of the management team and the board, our donations grew from 7.7 million to 10.8 million. And that really is I can't say enough how we appreciate our donor support and, the work of the whole team and the marketing and the fundraising team and also all the volunteers on the programs. The other income of 2.9 million that refers predominantly to our The fees that we charge for our educare services, or let's call them the creches, and also some government grants that, that we receive. And then in terms of expenditure, we now manage a budget of just over 10 million, which is getting to be a sizable organization. And again, Vision 2020 is giving us the skills to, you know, to have those on board that are able to manage that, that kind of budget. And again, the movement in the reserves or the surplus for the year was an amount of 2.8 million. So, you know, again, we are in a, had a strong year for donations, and those, you know, those funds will be spent in 2021. As you can see at the bottom there, the majority of that 2.7 million is related to restricted donations, which means that it's been allocated to a specific project and can only be spent on that specific project. If you go to the next slide. Here's a breakdown of the donation income by source. So, you know, we are broadening our base, and, you know, we are in the three main areas are the USA, the UK, and SA, South Africa. But of course, the contributions from other parts of the world is growing. And again, we thank, you know, we are excited about that, that we truly are, you know, fundraising more globally. The project funding for future periods, you can see there that we defer those projects, excuse me, those donations to the future, to next year. That priority is the Vision 2020 project. Details of the projects are to follow in Millie and her team's report, so I'm not going to go into the detail of the projects, but just at this stage reporting the numbers. And then the next note, you can see the breakdown of the cash. So restricted donations, the project funding for future periods, and then also the operating funds. You know, it's important for us that we, during this year, or actually last year, we implemented a process where we need to ensure that our sustainability, so that we've set aside funds for the future, so that Masi can operate sustainably while still delivering on the projects and not affecting you know, the work that's done on these projects. Yeah. Okay, next slide, please. This is the breakdown of the spending. So there's the 10.5 million budget that I referred to. And you can see, you know, just about 33% of it is the early childhood development, or the ECD, which Fiona and her team run. And then we have various other projects, the Okanyo project, the bigger ones, the skills development, the community support, and then Vision 2020, which again is I've mentioned before, and that's the how we're spending that money. And lastly is the COVID support. So in this financial year is a unique one, and we, you know, we received donations and we spent money on supporting the community with COVID, you know, related support, whether that was cleaning or sanitizing or food. There was a variety of programs for that. So I think that's the details of the projects will be covered in the next slide. So I'd like to hand over to Millie and her team, who will take you through the projects.
Good evening, everybody. I join you to report back on our activities of 2020. COVID-19 disrupted most of the world in 2020 and beyond. We had to learn about rapid change, uncertainty, and new way to do things. And our annual report reflects how we were able to adapt our programs in line with COVID. But I think most importantly, to look at the highlights that we were still able to celebrate despite the circumstances. Next slide, please, Terry. We had to adapt our programs, and we had to look at the resources on hand, mainly in our temporary program closures, the impact on our programs, and we'll speak more about that later. We also needed to adapt and work virtually where as much as possible. And I think really a key thing that stood out for me last year was how we supported the work of others, and really sort of everybody got involved and rolled up their sleeves. And we looked at the resources that we had on hand, and we formed and grew some significant partnerships. And you can see mainly in the areas of community feeding, hygiene and PPE, as well as learning. But special mention needs to be made of our partnership with the Masi Creative Hub under the leadership of Yandiswa Maswana. And we partnered together on a number of feeding initiatives, and these efforts really spearheaded our work in the community. Next slide, please. Early childhood development. You can see from the slide, we have 266 children enrolled at our two ECD centers. And our COVID support was mainly in the area of fee support. As you can imagine, many of the parents lost their jobs and were unable to pay school fees. And so we helped with our creche fee support there, as well as the monthly packs. And these monthly packs were handed out to the children and their parents. And there was lots of different goodies in the pack. They had books and learning materials and vouchers as well. And we were able to support this in this way within 5 months. And I think what was key for me was with ECD was how the ECD centers became a safe haven for the children. We had excellent good practices in place, and the children were able to continue with learning. And I really commend Fiona as director of ECD and what she was able to achieve with her team, Vicky Rattray, as well as the principals at both creches. Next slide, please. Nurturing preschool. We have 280 children enrolled in our stay and play program, which is the support given to what we used to always refer to as backyard shack pressures. And we were able to continue with that despite lockdown. We were also able to distribute hygiene packs, about 600 hygiene packs to families in the ECD centers. And I think also quite noticeable for us was how we used to expand our feeding program to the children. So the children could receive two meals daily, as well as a fruit. And that is something that we've had to continue with in 2021. Next slide, please. And I think it was one of the celebrations was that four of our teachers completed their ECD training last year. And we really commend them for being able to achieve this through COVID. You can see on the slide, our budget for ECD is 3.5 million. And I think, you know, that comes to almost a third of our entire Masicorp budget. So I think that really speaks about how heavily invested we are in early childhood development, because we know it has a lasting benefit with regards to schooling. Next slide, please. Bukanyo Primary School. This was a huge challenge for the school and for the community. And probably one of the greatest challenges, I think, you know, when you have a school of 1,900 plus pupils, you know, how do you now give them access to learning with the schools being closed? And obviously the children do not have access to data or online learning, which many children, you know, other schools have. But the school was able to do physical handouts in the community. The parents would come and collect the work from the school teachers. And it was quite something to witness with everybody lining up in queues, going down the street to come and collect work for their children. I was incredibly proud of our Masicorp staff at Okanyo, because for the while that their programs were locked down, they all rolled up their sleeves and came to help in other programs where staff needed extra support with sanitizing or registering pupils or just extra work. So I really commend our Kanyo team for chipping in there. I think another huge challenge at Kanyo Primary School was that when the school closed, so did school feeding. And you would know that so many children rely on that one cooked meal a day. But I'm very proud of NGOs who and other organizations who got together and really opened about 9 community kitchens in the community to make sure that the children were not going hungry. And this was done until the school feeding was able to kick in again. And however, Masi Creative Hub and various other feeding partners all continued with feeding within the community. Next slide, please. Masi sports program. So as the schools closed, so had to the sports program. But the coaches kept themselves busy and engaged with the children, and they sent them some exercise videos to complete at home. And I'm sure you managed to see some of the Facebook posts that we had regarding that. The MCC feeding support, they were able to support both the primary and the high school with feeding support. And you can see there was a number of children, in addition to that, received daily meals, and a number of families were able to receive support for about 4 months. The coaches there as well also assisted the school with feeding as well as sanitizing. So you can imagine something like sanitizing becomes a massive undertaking in a school this size. So we commend the staff for that as well. Next slide. The English Please program, which is run at both Simonstown Primary and Fisher Primary School. We were contacted quite early in lockdown, with the schools faced a challenge of how to access or to give access to their pupils, as they had no data and they weren't able to access the online learning. So we helped to facilitate physical drop-offs in the community for school packs for schools. In addition to that, we kept our program going through COVID by distributing Let's Keep Learning packs. And we call this our Let's Keep Learning campaign. And the children had work to complete, which they would then regularly return, and we would mark and give it back to them. They had always a fun treat. Teacher Millie is always known for her bar ones or her sweets. And we kept that going. And we also gave them vouchers to purchase stationery, or to access data so they can get messages from the school. I think another challenge faced by a school was suddenly the cost of paper. And you can imagine when you're having to hand it out to the community. So we were able to help Simonstown Primary School with a donation of paper. We also started a WhatsApp learning initiative, and there was a lovely Facebook post of a young lady who was really struggling with reading, and how she had radically improved her reading just by taking part in the WhatsApp lessons with Jane Futter. You can see there, we also had 25 children who regularly received their work packs. And for me, it was just amazing to watch parents and children turn up. We literally had to open the boot of a car and hand out the packs to the children. And Kanya Primary School very kindly allowed us to use the driveway. So it would always remain a wonderful photograph to see that how learning was still happening within our Masicorp programs, regardless of lockdown. Next slide, please. As you can see, our Masicorp Malele teams were also hard hit by COVID. So we were able to support them with data, which was vital. Not only to access some of the online work from schools, because we need to recall that some of the children go to school outside the valley and they were mainly online. So like, for example, Fishwick High School. But also we were able to make use of our ICDL center, where they could access some of their work as well as watch some videos on extra lessons on the various subjects. We also provided grocery vouchers for our sewing and our art program teams. And our maths program, under the leadership of Rob Douglas from Fisher High School, he set up a WhatsApp group for the grade 12s. And so they were able to continue to share important information. Next slide. Community support and lifelong learning, Evangeline Life Skills Program, which focuses on sewing, computers, and English lessons. And this program was also hard hit by COVID. We weren't able to run at full capacity. However, the determination of the team, we were very pleased to see that 19 students graduated, and it was a wonderful celebration with Wendy Ryan and her team and her teachers, which was held at the Living Hope premises. We were also, during lockdown, able to assist the families with grocery vouchers as well. Thank you. Next slide. Our computer training. I think the opening of the ICDL Centre has to be the highlight of last year. And it happened right before COVID hit us. But we had a wonderful, wonderful opening of the ICDL Centre. And Jane Philippi from the US was here. And you can see in the photo cutting the ribbon. And with the team led by Niasha Satoli and our two trainers. And the centre became such a hub during COVID, because not only was it used for high school pupils to access data, but I think the main thing was how this team continued with training despite lockdown. And the team made incredible videos, which they were able to share with their students, so that the learning could actually continue. Because the Massey Library Computer Centre had to close last year and regrettably is still closed. In addition, we had, the centre was open and the high school students were able to use it, as I've mentioned. But the good news was that we had 71 ICDL students who were able to graduate last year, and that is absolutely phenomenal considering the difficulty that they had. Next slide, please. As mentioned earlier, there was a devastating fire in section D and E of the wetland in Masicorp just before Christmas. You can see we have 1,000 homes who were badly affected. So you can imagine how many people that would equal to. But it was incredible. With the help of our fundraising team, we managed to raise 200,000 rand, and we were actually able to supply blankets at this time. And the reason people often ask us why blankets, and that was what we were asked at the time. Living Hope really spearheads the distribution, and together we agreed that Masicorp would supply some of the blankets, which we did. And in addition, we also donated to the other efforts of Living Hope at this time. I commend our staff who, even though it was supposedly holiday time, turned up to volunteer to help pack and sort donations. And I really commend them for that. In addition to that, we were also able to assist any of our direct beneficiaries who are involved in our programs with fire relief support as well. That's the report back for 2020. I'd just like to thank our Masicorp team, our many friends of Masicorp who continue to support us last year and continue to support us through this year. Everybody just came together, rolled up their sleeves and really looked at how could they do better for Masicorp Malele in 2020. And I really commend everybody and for that. And I just want to thank them for the part that they've played in that. Thank you. That's our report. And I'll now hand over to Megan Pringle, our senior fundraiser, and she will report back on the fundraising activities we had last year.
Hi, everybody. I think as Millie said, when we first heard about the lockdown here in South Africa, we were Hello?
We can hear you.
Okay. You know, when we first heard about the lockdown, I think we were all in a bit of a state of shock. But very quickly, it was replaced by how do we help the people of Masi through this? And it's been an absolutely humbling experience to see how many people actually care for the community. You know, we spent months sharing our updates and all the ways that we were supporting. We also appealed to all our donors and our followers for help. And as Alistair showed you, we were able to raise over R1 million towards the COVID relief and the lockdown education. I think that really speaks to the spirit of generosity that we have in our supporters. You know, we had funds coming from all over the world, as well as incredible support from our local surrounding communities, which was fantastic. We also had volunteer fundraising teams that we work closely with in the UK, in the US, in the Netherlands, and all of them together absolutely pulled out all the stops to help us raise the funds we needed. So I would just like to thank them and acknowledge them for being such a dynamic, and they're an incredible source of support and inspiration to us here in South Africa. So thank you for that. I'm also just very proud of our whole team, actually, who, as Millie mentioned, pivoted so quickly to do what needed to be done to support the community. The way that we worked with other organizations to getting help to those who needed it has actually kind of become a blueprint for going forward, as you know, in a collaborative way. And it's actually the way that we should all strive to work. And I think that was one of our learnings from 2020. I think it's also important to mention how many of our regular funders were also very quick to allow us to be more flexible in how we spent the funding that they gave us, committed funding that they'd already given us. I think that they really understood there would be a need to either adapt our programs or maybe reallocate the funds to where we needed it most. So, you know, we and other organizations in the same boat as us, I think we all really appreciated this flexibility that our funders showed during 2020. And it's also promising in terms of future support and growing those kind of relationships, that it's not just an expectation of accountability and transparency, but also that there's a level of trust from funders, that they can trust the organizations that they're supporting in how best to deliver their work. In terms of our visits, our visitors during 2020, we normally have a lot of people coming through to see us and visiting our programs. And unfortunately, during COVID, we unfortunately had to cancel many of those visits. And we haven't really had anybody come through since March last year, not just because of COVID protocols, but simply because there's a lot of people from overseas that haven't been traveling. We know that when somebody visits Masi, when they see our community staff members in action, when they meet our beneficiaries, you know, they can't help but walk away feeling changed and inspired, you know, to get involved. It's just very impactful to see it on the ground in person. So, you know, we always love to share our successes. We love to share our stories and successes of our programs and the work that we're doing. But for us, it's just very important to also for people to see the real need in the community, so they can understand firsthand the reason why we do what we do. So hopefully in next year, 2020, we can slowly start opening up and welcoming more visitors back into our programs. Very important for our fundraising efforts. So going forward, I think in terms of fundraising, we are cautiously optimistic, but I think very aware of the fact that economically our funding support will probably be affected post-COVID, like many other organizations. We already are seeing a decline in funding opportunities, in donor budgets. Some funders are restricting the support that they give and only supporting those that are very close to them or their existing organizations they support. So this will definitely affect how much we can raise next year. But with that in mind, just to counteract that and ensure the security of our programs and what we do, as Alistair mentioned, we have put in place a sustainability, a project savings policy to save funds for our programs. We also have launched a legacy program as well for sustainability. the Vision 2020 that was mentioned, which was launched and run by our US team, has actually helped us in raising capacity within the organization in terms of vital positions. So we can increase our fundraising capacity, we can improve our program and organizational strategy, and all of these ways will help us give us security going forward. We've also focused on growing our individual monthly giving program as well. And most importantly, I think we learned from those challenges of 2020. I think that was the main thing which is going to be helping us going forward. How do we tighten our belts? How do we be more resilient and flexible and adaptable going forwards? And, you know, these are just some of the ways that we'll be able to ensure that Masicorp will survive what could possibly be a difficult next few years, basically. So I'd like to just finish up by saying thank you, an enormous thank you to everyone that supported us and continues to support us, either with funds or with their time as a volunteer. I think that 2020 last year will definitely go down as a time in history when, despite everything, all the challenges and the worries and the fears, people really stepped up to help others. And we saw that all over the world. So we'd really just like to share a few words from some of our community staff who'd like to thank everyone for the support last year and going forward. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Uma, one of the ICDL trainers. As the ICDL Center, we managed to work with the high school students around Masipumelele, offering them computer basic skills, which would be essential for them when they do their assignments and for the future. As the team, we would like to thank all our supporters for their amazing support.
Hi everyone, my name is Tula from the Maths Lab. I would like to mention some of the amazing work that had been done in the last year. It is such an honor to be able to give back to the learners of Masipumelele and to see them excel in mathematics, which will help them in other areas. I would like to thank the community and all our supporters for the ongoing support. We are really looking forward for another year of education. Thank you.
Hi everyone, my name is Yandi Somazwana. I'm the community liaison officer for Masicorp. I would like to say thank you very much to everybody who have supported our program, which is Stay and Play. We have made a very good impact to our community during lockdown in 2020 last year. We have lost a few creches that have come back on the ground this year. We have managed to support them with everything that they needed. We have also recruited this year, and we recruited 18 preschools, and we have managed to supply them with all the boxes of the art material. We are really grateful and very, very, very thankful to everyone who have been kindly supporting the program. Thank you.
Right. We asked you at the beginning if you had any questions, please write them in the chat group as we're going along. And I'd like to ask you now that if you have any questions on the finances or the day-to-day running of our organization or on the fundraising, please could you put them in the chat group now? I've just got one message I see in the chat group as a comment, but it came from Wendy Ryan saying, Evangeline, thanks Masicorp for the food help given to our students during that difficult time last year. Thanks, Wendy. All positive responses are well received. But now we need some questions, please. It can't be the first AGM in world history not to have a question in it. So I'm looking in hope. I only see five faces there. So
there's actually 35 people on the Zoom, but only five with cameras on, the four speakers.
Okay. Well, I won't ask you to put in a question if you don't have one. But I would like to say, though, that I hope that next year that we are able to have an AGM where we see one another. It's very, very disconcerting looking at a bank screen and talking, that I can tell you. And I hope next year I can look. I've been a school teacher all my life, and I've looked at blank faces in a classroom, but it's not quite the same thing. And so I hope that next year we have an AGM where we can all get together and have conversation going back and forth. So if there are no questions, I'd like to thank the three speakers, Millie, for keeping the whole ship going, the finances from Alistair, thank you for your professionalism there, and Megan, thank you for your passion in the fundraising and keeping that going. You introduced a note of soberness at the end there, warning us that the year ahead could be a little bit more tricky. We're aware of that, but I think with the team that we got in hand, we'll hopefully be able to see our way through. You know, South Africa has been through tough times in the last couple of weeks, and added to that the fire and COVID and so on, but the country is going through negative times. And I think when Millie used a very interesting word there about light, I would like to think that the contributions of all our donors, of all our volunteers, of our team on the ground and the board, I think that we are supplying light. And I don't know if those of you from overseas saw the images of Masicorp during this time of crisis that we had, but the posters saying down with looters and the community coming together in a positive way. And I found that very heartwarming. So thank you to everyone who's played a role in that, and that in amongst all this gloom, we've got this light. So on that note, as evening descends on us, I'll leave you with that thought, and with what Megan said when she said she found the work done by all the volunteers and the donors inspiring. And inspiring means to breathe life into. So thank you for all of you breathing life into this wonderful little gem that we have called Masicorp.
Thank you. Keith, are you happy I end the meeting?
And I'm happy you end the meeting, and good night to everybody.
Thank you, everyone.